7 years. You see, under the rules of the court, under the rules of the High Court for subordinate judiciary, every district judge is required to inspect every civil court under him once in a year. Every presiding officer of the court is required to inspect his own office once in every 3 months, and also to inspect his own department quarterly. Now, this kind of thing was going on for 7 long years. Was anybody inspecting? Nobody was inspecting. We need an external agency. We need an external monitor to watch over the operations which are going on. Now, the question is, how should this malaise be remedied? It's needless to multiply instances. I mean, it's now in the air that there is corruption in subordinate judiciary. Now, for higher judiciary, the Judicial Standards Accountability Bill of 2010 has conceived an oversight committee and scrutiny panels to inquire into misconduct of High Court and Supreme Court judges. That matter is pending there. I'm not on it. We are examining the methodology for subordinate courts. So if there can be such a system for High Court and Supreme Court judges, I believe we should be able to have one for subordinate judiciary as well. The subordinate courts function under the control of the High Court under Article 235. The Registrar Vigilance of the High Court has to look into the complaints against judicial officers. Some of the High Court judges are designated also as administrative judges to make annual inspections to address maladministration in the districts allotted to them. This machinery has not been able to check administration, not able to check the growing menace of corruption in district courts, as none of them has adequate time to handle the volume of work associated with thousands of courts and judges. Remedies suggested by the Supreme Court, High Court, certain commissions like Malimat Commission, First National Judicial Pay Commission of Justice K.J. Shetty of the Supreme Court, they have not been implemented. Some time back we were talking about the judge population ratio. See, it was pointed out that in India, for 1 million population, we have got 12 judges, as against USA, which has 107, or Canada 75, UK 51. In the All India Judicial Association's case, which was presided over by Justice Venkat Chelia, who was here, the Supreme Court had recommended to raise the strength to 50 judges per million of population. Now, it is a far long story. Vacancies remain unfilled over years. Chief Justice of India, this is Justice Balakrishnan, only recently, Justice Balakrishnan said that we need 5,000 more courts. All India Judicial Service also was talked about in the earlier session, Article 342. This was brought in by the 42nd Amendment of the Constitution in the year 1977. And both in 1992, the Supreme Court and our Justice Shetty's Commission later on recommended that we must have an All India Judicial Service, and as envisaged by Article 342. It is not coming to being. This is not being. You see, one of the problems which you are facing, which you are discussing about, is the unwillingness of the establishment, of the government, to do enough to control the menace or curb the menace. So these are the instances. Now, at the national level, let us see how we stand. And then in the Committee of Nations, how does India stand? There is Corruption Perception Index of 2010. This is by the Transparency International at Berlin. And the data which I am going to give is not merely the table exercise of the Transparency International, but it is supported by investigation by 10 international organizations, we are experts in these, this kind of a survey. And I can just quote some of them to you. The corruption index I am going to talk about was made by 10 independent internationally reputed institutions like World Bank and IBRD, Global Insight, Bertelsmann Foundation, IMD World Competitiveness Yearbook on Institutional Framework, and World Economic Forum. These are 5 out of 10. So nobody has an opportunity to say this kind of a data is a manufactured one or got of one. It's highly authentic. And what is the data? What is it? Countries with noticeable little corruption have index. They have made a scale of 0 to 10. They adopted a scale of 0 to 10 in fixing the index figure of a particular country. 0 means most corrupt. 10 means not corrupt. In between, there is variation. So, countries with noticeably little corruption having index between 9.7 and 7 have a system of judicial ombudsman. All these countries have got a system of judicial ombudsman. For example, Finland, Denmark, Sweden, USA. While India stands at the low index of 3.3. At 3.3. And mind you, this is the declining index. It's not as if by some chance it is at 3.3. No, it's not like that. It was 3.5 in 2007. It fell to 3.4 in 2008 and 2009. And in 2003, we are at 3.3. This is a story of a declining integrity of the nation in the Committee of Nations in the worldwide. And as I said, the countries which have adopted the system of judicial ombudsman, they are free from. Just now, Kejriwal told, or somebody told in the previous session, Hong Kong has no corruption now because they have that system of ICAC. Presently, Singapore, our immediate neighbor, Singapore, is the least corrupt country in Asia and 5th in the world. Now, we are ranked with countries like what? Countries like Albania, Jamaica, Liberia. India is in that group of countries from the corruption point of view. That is the irony of the whole thing. A great country, a great ancient country of high spiritual standard and all that. 20 minutes. How many minutes left?
Over, okay.
All right, I'll escape up. See, I can invite your attention to the brochure, souvenir, which has been issued today, which is delivered everywhere. You will find my article on this subject. Judicial Ombudsman, you will find it printed there. So, I'll escape all that from what is there. And I just mentioned a few things. And it is this, the Sweden model, Finland model, Spain model, in USA, the Californian model. In ancient law, in the ancient Indian law, a judge who passed unjust orders had to be banished. He was liable to be punished with fine if he failed to inquire into relevant matters, or if he made unnecessary delay in discharge of his duty, including malafide, postponement of cases, etc. For imposing unjust fine, he was to be fined the double of the amount. Not that this can be adopted today, but what I mean to say is that this system of judges being monitored and taken to task for not performing is not a new one. This was there in the old ancient times too. Now the bar has also its own role to play. There have been so many complaints about the bar. Mr. Chokar, he spoke the about the debar, and I suppose this judicial ombudsman should be able to have powers even over the bar. Talking about the Contempt of Court Act, see, my own concept is that the statute which creates the ombudsman can ensure that in matters or facts or allegations or complaints which come to his cognizance for inquiry, no contempt of court proceeding can be taken or ought to be taken. An exemption is necessary. Just under the Right to Information Act, the powers conferred under the Act override the limitation under all other acts. It is over Section 22, which has overriding powers. Similarly, in the statute for judicial ombudsman, we can have a provision which will override all the provisions of contempt court or anything else. Now, I will conclude. See, as I said, we have got a registrar vigilance in every high court. Now, if a registrar vigilance can be appointed for investigating complaints against judicial officers, why not an ombudsman also? High Court, Supreme Court have been appointing special investigation teams, everybody knows. Someday are there, some kind of a commission is appointed by body of couple of person, 3% appointed by the High Court or Supreme Court, just to go and examine and monitor and report to the court. So, the High Court should agree to the constitution of an ombudsman if they are also appoint their own commissions, inquiry commissions to make reports on matters pending before them. Article 325, if necessary, should be amended. And similarly, the Advocates Act also needs to be amended. The total withdrawal of power of the High Court over the advocates by the Advocates Act has been very deleterious to the climate of the judge and advocate relationship. I now say that what you have to examine and consider what needs to be protected more, independence of judiciary or integrity of the judicial system, unfettered exercise of power or controlled service to the people. There is already a talk of cutting the relief under Article 311 of the Constitution of India in public services. This Additional Reforms Commission had recommended it that way also. If 311 can be touched, why 235 also cannot be touched? Well, see, old order changes, yielding place to new. Lest one good custom should corrupt the world. Change is a law of nature. Let us abide by the law and try to come to change through a judicial ombudsman. Thank you very much.